Hallownest is a video game developed by Australian indie studio Team Cherry. It's an extraordinary metroidvania, or rather metroid-like, with stunning graphics and an exceptional soundtrack by Australian composer Christopher Larkin, set in the fictional kingdom of Hallownest, whose inhabitants are mostly insects. Tons of insects. Insects pretty much everywhere. It's one of the most beautiful video games I've ever seen and played, which is easy, you could say, considering my very modest video game knowledge. And it has, since its release in 2017, been critically acclaimed, as we are now all hoping for its sequel, the much-awaited Silk Songs, to be announced. But it's okay, Team Cherry. Take all the time you need. We will wait. Hallownest became my favorite game just thanks to this image. It was a few weeks or months before I discovered Gris, the game that really introduced me to the world of video games, when I was looking for a way to escape from a long melancholy. The simplicity of the drawn character, which still allowed me to grasp the beauty of the art style through this light effect and the details in the background, the confident stance, weapon in full view, letting me guess the type of challenge that would await me if I tried to play it, the contrast between the roundness of the hero's little limbs and the energy that emanated from them, giving depth to their eyes which, as a result, seemed no longer empty. I was fascinated. Fortunately, the game's title was mentioned next to the illustration, otherwise it would have been more difficult. I looked up the story before I even saw what the game looked like. Only later did I watch the whole game. At first I didn't play it, doubting my gaming abilities, and there, second shock. Green Path. That music. Crystal clear counterpoint, meticulous orchestration, and most of all a very moving narrative dimension. When I finally got more time and a decent computer, shortly after playing Gris, I decided to tackle my very first action game. I could have chosen something simpler. And after that I tried Celeste. Yeah, I know, cruel. Go figure. While we are patiently waiting for the release of its sequel, Silk Song, I wanted to take the time to enjoy all the artistic aspects of Team Cherry and Christopher Larkin's masterpiece, and even though it isn't the first series I'm doing, it's actually thanks to this game that I had the idea for my previous blog, which is now this YouTube channel. At the time I was only missing, well, time, and this time I suddenly got it without really asking for it, so here I am. Yay! Doing this series is an evidence for me, yet I still am a bit apprehensive. There are certainly many articles and videos on Hallownest, some of them very exhaustive. I have hardly looked at any of them, it would have made no sense. What I'm doing on this channel is completely personal because this game is very dear and personal to me. However, I do not pretend to shed new light on the work, yet I tried to. It is highly likely that you will find elements already mentioned or even well established, as this game is now more than 5 years old. But I couldn't imagine not talking about my favorite video game and my favorite composer on this channel. There will be several videos in this series which I entitled A Catharsis of Melancholy, 3 videos. Next video will be an analysis of Hallownest soundtrack. After that, I'd have a close look at the game's graphics and gameplay. But first, in this video, I'd like to talk about the lore and the NPCs. I won't mention here much of the DLC content. Yeah, sorry about that, Divine. Maybe the series, like the game, will have its own DLC. I'm not sure. Lastly, I don't pretend here to be exhaustive, just to begin the analysis of the game through the strong points of its history. I know that some of my viewers haven't played Hallownest, and I'd like for them to have an idea of what it's about. And as Hollow Knight is a game in which all the elements, whether it is the story, the gameplay, the music, all of them are connected, some events or characters that are not mentioned in this video will probably be mentioned in a later one, depending on what seems the most relevant to me. That being said, let's begin. The radiance was a being of light, a higher being even more luminous than essence, a form of energy that dreams are made of. She wasn't living in the physical world, she was living in the dream realm. The radiance gave birth from light to the moth tribe, which in return idolized her, but without possessing any form of intelligence. They were only guided by their instinct. This tribe had the ability to manipulate dreams. There were other tribes like mostly the bees, the mantises, the moskin tribe, the mushroom clan, the spiders, and bugs. Many bugs. One day, a worm, an immense worm, came to die at the edge of Hallownest. Its corpse, the cast of shell, rotting, disintegrating into white ashes like gloomy snow covering the ground, that very snow we constantly see on the screen. Yet this worm changed appearance. Was it a metamorphosis or a rebirth? There's an egg inside the worm's corpse. This worm then became the Paid King, a radiant monarch with a crown and the features of a small bug, just like most of the inhabitants of Hallownest. He granted them sapience so that in return the inhabitants would venerate him, this king who promised them an eternal kingdom. And he kept his word. The Paid King, with his wife, the White Lady, also a higher being, shaped like a root and apparently constantly growing, built a large kingdom, buried yet radiant, between the Howling Cliffs and Crystal Peak, with two underground transport networks, a tramway and, better, a stagway. Ring the bell and a stag will burst in, kindly growling, taking you wherever needed. He also built the City of Tears, the capital of Hallownest, and the royal waterways that support it. This is an aspect I will develop in the video on graphics and gameplay, but one of the distinctive characteristics of the Paid King is that of an engineer, in a way. Hallownest abounds with elevators and lever-operated doors that show a great architectural virtuosity, which blends very organically with the lush vegetation and the color palette so distinctive of some areas, essentially Green Path and the Queen's Gardens. The City of Tears is a feat of engineering in itself. It is built below a huge lake whose cyan-hued water seeps through the stone without ever collapsing, recreating the illusion of a perpetual rain which can sort of resonate with the sweet melancholy of some of the inhabitants. Don't you think so, Cruel?
Nah, me nobis!
Yeah, I thought you would agree. The king lived in the White Palace, buried deep down in the ancient basin, while the queen appropriated a specific area of Hallownest, now called the Queen's Gardens, but which were previously part of the lands of Un, a higher being who from her dreams gave birth to the Moskin tribe, now only living in a smaller part of Green Path, yet allowing the king to build roads through these lovely caverns. The kingdom was also protected by the five great knights, Tria, Egemol, Isma, Ogrim, and Zemir, and other warriors, like Mamu, protector of the Queen's Gardens, or Galien, No Eyes, and Xero. This worship of the king extended to more than bugs, like the mushrooms, which were also endowed with intelligence. Yeah, they were too. And eventually to the moth tribe. The radiance was thus forgotten by her very own creations. She then wished to remind them of her and began to infiltrate the dreams of almost all creatures in the form of a light as blinding as a sun. They try to fight against this memory, yet the Radiance managed to bind the bug's mind to her owner, unleashing an infection that may have been unintentional at first, but soon the Radiance was able to control it so as to enslave nearly all of Hallownest's creatures, infecting them both physically and mentally. Faced with the infection, someone, or something, had to be able to completely annihilate this light. What could be better for that than the pure darkness of the void? Indeed, not far from the White Palace where the king hid at the very bottom of Hallownest, in a rather disturbing place, full of meaning, the abyss, there's this odd substance that can be found and that the king, at the time, discovered. It can attack, it seems almost sentient, like a strange vantablack that could be tamed by light, but could just as easily absorb the purest light, that of the Radiance, and make it disappear forever. The king discovered this substance and began to experiment with it, notably creating guards for his own palace, the king's mold. In order to channel this infection, the pale king decided to create a pure, thus perfect container for this plague, a vessel which would be able to contain it and seal the Radiance away. He gave birth to thousands of little vessels, children of the two paid beings, the paid king and the white lady, which, all but one, a priori, ended up at the bottom of the abyss. These vessels, siblings, brothers or sisters, since they have no gender, were born from the union of two souls, the king's, soul of worm, and the queen's, soul of fruit, as well as from void. Indeed, when the vessels die, their shell shatters and releases a shadow made of void. This substance seems to attack indiscriminately and needs to be unified in order to act differently and contain the infection. This requires a specific charm, the void heart, symbol of the three constitutive elements of the vessel, soul of worm, soul of fruit, heart of void. The only vessel that was allowed to leave the abyss, the supposedly perfect vessel with no mind, no will, no voice, so empty and pure that it could contain this corruption, is the Hollow Knight, the eponymous character. The Pale King chose them, raised them, we can see him briefly sharing some time with the Hollow Knight, then chained them in the Temple of the Black Egg, alone. To ensure that this vessel would continue to protect the kingdom, the king added another protection to the temple and sealed its entrance by putting three insects into a deep sleep. Monomon the Teacher, Lorien the Watcher, and Hera the Beast. Hera, queen of the spider tribe, who never accepted the king, agreed on the condition that he would unite his soul with hers in a dalliance. She then gave birth to Hornet, also known as the gender child, seeing as all the king's children have no gender, except for her. The Hollow Knight and the three dreamers all retained the infection and the radiance in the dream realm. She could no longer infect insects. However, the vessel was not entirely pure, perhaps because of the time spent with their father the king, and the infection seeped again into the minds of the people of Hallownest. That's what we can see in the introduction of the game. The Hollow Knight's shell broke, and we saw very bright orange light. The dreamer's seal was broken, and the infection spread again. Most people died, sometimes piling up in some areas of the kingdom, leaving only a few of the inhabitants still unharmed, like Elderbug. Those who were alive but infected remained underground in the kingdom, working in Crystal Peak, or attacking any healthy insect, probably manipulated by the Radiance herself. Most of them even seem to be now dead, poor husks wandering aimlessly, endlessly. Of all the species of Hallownest, however, the mantises have met different fates. Some of the mantises, led by the mantis lord, avoided getting infected, as is shown by the fact that they do not emit orange clouds of infection while they hit, like for any infected bug. The other mantises invaded the queen's gardens where they were infected, or maybe was it before leaving the mantis tribe. They were led by the mantis lord's brother, the traitor lord whose throne was then destroyed by his sisters. Yet most of the bugs, whether it was when the infection first attacked them or now, turned against each other, sometimes even against the king, like Zero did, or Elder Hu, a mage who blindly attacked the non-infected mantises in their village down fungal wastes. The Pale King suddenly disappeared, as well as the White Palace where he lived, while the White Lady, ashamed to be related to the creation of the vessels, locked herself up in a cave guarded by one of the five great knights, restricted her movements to prevent her from developing further and creating new vessels, and became gradually blind, except for the little hero she mentions seeing clearly, and deaf. But maybe this is only due to the knights remaining silent. Unable to move, she doesn't know that Rhea, the knight who used to guard her, is dead, defeated by the mantises from the gardens, but she is aware that the infection is back in Hallownest. All the impure vessels piled up in the abyss, sealed by the king after the Hollow Knight was chosen. Still, it seems that some managed to escape, as some of them are found in Hallownest. They died, notably one who seems to be a victim of Hornet. Was it a test? She is an outstanding fighter, and each one of her encounters engages us in an acrobatic and virtuoso battle. Another vessel ends up dying not far from the abyss, at the bottom of the ancient basin. We will study your music in detail, broken vessel. But most of all, one of these vessels fled from the kingdom before returning, nail in hand, in order to save Hallownest, the knight who is no other than the character the player controls. Did the hero call from the Radiance or from the White Lady, or even from the Hollow Knight themselves? To eradicate the infection, they must therefore defeat the Radiance by accessing the Hollow Knight's dreams. It is only after a thorough exploration of Hallownest that the knight finds the three dreamers and seals the temple and prison themselves before the eponymous Hollow Knight. At what cost? Although Hollow Knight features deities, in any case higher beings, who are able to give life to creatures, the Moth tribe for the Radiance, the Moskin tribe for Un, and for another one, the Pale King, to give them a form of intelligence, the story of Hollow Knight is based on deeply human feelings. One of them, and maybe the key element, is the fear of oblivion, the fear of being forgotten. The Radiance has been forgotten and wanted to remind the Moth tribe of their creator. One can imagine that it is all the more painful for her that the kingdom gives much importance to remembrance, to homage. We see it through the memorial dedicated to the Hollow Knight, surrounded by the three dreamers, and the statues or tombs of dream warriors, Gorbin the Howling Cliffs in particular. Not to mention the resting grounds, another place of remembrance where large statues of the dreamers stand at the entrance, and Rivik guards the tombs of countless warriors looked after by the seer, a moth herself, the last one. Above all, the veneration towards the Pale King is almost boundless. Idols in the shape of the king are made and owned. The whole kingdom is built in his image, since its architecture is based on Hallownest steel, which shows the king's crown. On the other hand, the Radiance is barely mentioned, and her only statue is out of sight, inaccessible and damaged, as if abandoned, at the top of Crystal Peak. Hallownest isn't completely silent. Some of its inhabitants tell a story, others have carved words on mossy stones. There is a large place for memory and worship in the kingdom, but there is no place for the Radiance. Not anymore. Only her infection would remain. Yet, despite this apparent emphasis on remembrance and the sacrifice of the Hollow Knight, this oblivion I mentioned is also that of the vessels, more precisely, the vessel's fate. The abyss was sealed after the departure of the Hollow Knight, and only someone with the King's brand, found in the cast of Shell, can enter it again. Lem, the collector... No, not this one. Surrounded by relics, puts his finger on the fog surrounding this inscription on the fountain, the Hollow Knight Memorial. Little is now known about this story, this sacrifice, and this is probably not a good sign. The Pale King is surrounded by a mysterious aura, his arrival seems quite unexplainable, and if his crown reminds us of his former identity as Wyrm, we find similar traits in the Radiance, notably those particular horns. What could be the reason? How could this monarch be reborn and rule the kingdom? And most of all, what could have led him to this blindness, this madness, in his response to the infection? The whole kingdom seems locked in oblivion, like Bretta, who was actually forgotten, lost in the Mantis village, although Elderbug remembers her afterwards, or Quirrell, who has lost his memory and is inexplicably drawn to the kingdom, then the archive at the heart of Fog Canyon. A second key element for me in the story of Hollow Knight lies in the metaphor of the choice made by the Pale King by choosing one of the vessels as the vessel, the Hollow Knight. When you see them together, piling up at the lowest point of Hallownest in the depths of the abyss, the vessels are different. They have a distinctive shell, not each one of them, which would be slightly time-consuming, but we can see different shapes. This is interesting, even necessary, from a graphic point of view, of course, but more than that, it is important insofar as it individualizes them, whereas they are presented as identical, given the function for which they were created, and above all without mind, without will, without voice. Yet they are indeed different. Since only one of them was considered perfect, it should mean that the others were not like the true vessel, the Hollow Knight. It is true that the vessels are not only made of void, since they are children of the Pale Beings, and share as such the soul of a root and the soul of a worm. However, we don't really know what those two souls give them. This void is not nothing, it is not absence, it is a substance, or even more, since it has been opposed to the Radiance before, apparently. There was indeed something here before Hallownest, since, for instance, the soul totems in Hallownest were made by another civilization long before the King arrived. And the creatures made of void, at least the vessels, have reactions that assume more than consciousness. The broken vessel extends a paw to their sibling in a last gesture of despair. The Hollow Knight twice has meaningful gazes. As they are about to leave the abyss with the King, they turn one last time to the depths. At the end of the path of pain, they are seen looking at their father. Much later, when they fought, they let out piercing screams that stun during the combat. Elderbug even mentions them. But most of all, there is this vessel whose aura escapes no one. Most of those who meet us immediately attribute superior fighting qualities to us, a strength despite a small stature. The Queen herself recognizes our superiority over the vessel chosen by the King, but for her, our superiority is our purity. But what does this purity represent, fundamentally? The choice, that of the Pale King, gave a strong individuality to the Hollow Knight. The origin of their impurity is not mentioned in the game. The White Lady simply evokes an idea instilled. However, it seems rather obvious that it is those very moments spent outside the abyss, in the company of their father, that may have tarnished the supposed purity of the Hollow Knight. For if we can think that the king just did not recognize the initial impurity of the vessel, we can also interpret that he did not imagine that by choosing them he was, from the Hollow Knight's point of view, giving them a special place which could alter their original purity. Thus, the mistake would not have been the choice itself, it would not have been choosing the wrong vessel. Maybe what the king did wrong was not thinking that choosing any vessel and spending time with them would have tarnished them, whoever they were. The Hollow Knight was recognized, in a way, by the father, by the king, moreover, and I find that if we take some time to think about it, the game raises an important question, a deeply human question. Is the importance some people give us, sometimes by becoming friends, partners, essential to help us building ourselves as individuals? It is in the conclusion that I will explore a more personal interpretation of Hollow Knight's story. Finally, this metaphor of how we shape our personality, how we accept our individuality, is found in the way some characters are treated. Some are seen through their function only, essentially the king and the Hollow Knight. The former is almost exclusively presented as a sovereign. Little is known about him since he was, according to Lem, living as a recluse in his palace. Therefore, it is difficult to get a complete picture of the king, of his character, except for what he accomplished as Hallownest's monarch and the sacrifice he imposed on the vessel. It is this sacrifice that characterizes the Hollow Knight in their entirety as a negation of their potential identity, an identity that they possess because of their supposed impurity. It is an idea that has been transposed in an astonishing way in the music of the game, using essentially two themes, leitmotif rather, very rightly associated for one with royalty, for the other with the vessels. The music of the fight against the Hollow Knight in particular shows great narrative virtuosity. We will talk about it at length in the next video. There is another character seen in a partial way, it is the Radiance. Almost by metonymy, she is only seen as the infection, as this plague that she is spreading. She is only known by the pain she feels, by this distress of having been forgotten, and by her response, which almost takes the form of revenge. In the end, Hallownest is seen only through the prism of the melancholy that seems to have descended upon it. And faced with this, the playable character, their silence, their supposed purity, brings a very particular response. They will act as sort of a mirror, something that will allow NPCs to find answers, to evolve, and at the strongest moment of the game, as the Hollow Knight seems to struggle to escape their function, their forced condition as a vessel, mutilated by the Radiance or even themselves, it is the Little Knight that will allow them to accept it, to transcend it by joining them to help them give the final blows to the Radiance. And it seems that this was their mission in a way, since the family disappears when the Radiance is defeated. That's why, despite all the care given to the NPCs, their characters so varied, their destinies as if locked in the soft yet deep darkness of the kingdom, no character from Hollow Knight fascinates me more than the little hero. Yet, it's still a particularly engaging element in this video game, which brilliantly shows all the variety and fluidity of emotions in the kingdom of Hallownest. The analysis of our little bugs continues with the non-player characters, or NPCs. Hollow Knight's NPCs are indeed the object of a very beautiful development. In a game of this extent, it is rather logical to meet many NPCs, even apart from enemies. They have rather usual functions, however, their treatment is such that they take an important place in both the story and the game experience without ever being intrusive. Some of them are merchants and allow the knight to buy accessories and upgrades, as usual in a video game. Iselda, the faithful wife of Conifer the cartographer, who hides in each area of Hallownest singing vigorously and goes back to his store snoring vigorously once his work is done. Millibel, a most dishonest banker, but she says Kalala to greet the knight and it's amusing.
Gio, Kalala.
You hear? I wasn't lying. The Forgotten Crossroads are also home to the small store of Cerubra, aka Charm Lover, who for a fee provides us with charms, these beautiful amulets that improve our abilities. It is always amusing to notice that those NPCs sound like they talk about money all the time. They briefly speak an imaginary language, and we often hear Gio, Hallownest's currency, in the syllables they pronounce.
Sego, Gio.
On the other hand, you can also earn money thanks to Reddick Sikalem, who is always eager to tell us more about the kingdom's history. Some of the merchants have a very strong relationship with money. Legator, Sly and his prices increasing again and again, or Tuk insist heavily on the need to pay them to obtain their precious merchandise. In the case of Legator, you even have to pay to have the right to see his merchandise. Sorry, I meant to say something nice. Something nice, Legator. Then pay for the charms themselves. One could say that this is classic behavior for merchants. However, I find that here their greed is not insignificant. In a kingdom where almost everything has been lost, you hold on to what you have left, or if you get rid of it, you expect a compensation. Money is also very nicely integrated in the game from geos that fossilized over time in the rough areas, Forgotten Crossroads, the Kingdom's Edge, Deep Nest, Ancient Basin, to the more elaborate yet abandoned chests mainly in the City of Tears. Hollow Knight is a rather long game, especially for a Metroid-like. It takes a few dozens hours to complete, and Silksong will most certainly be even longer. So it can feature more solid encounters and longer quests through repeated interactions with the same NPCs. This allows to build a relationship between the player, in place of the playable character since the knight doesn't seem to feel anything, and said NPCs. They then become, for some, almost companions. That's why other characters follow us throughout the game and provide valuable assistance. Among them, they are Quirrell, Cloth, and Hornet. And as I started to analyze in the previous part of this video, the regularity of those encounters, coupled with the silence of the little hero and their innocence, one might say, leads the characters to look at themselves to the point of making important decisions. Quirrell and Cloth are particularly touching. There are many encounters with Quirrell, who soon gives us a sweet nickname. In French, he says mon minuscule ami, which means my tiny friend. In English, it is very slightly different, my short friend. He raves about the City of Tears and the origin of the water that constantly showers the capital of Hallownest. He also warns us of Hallownest's dangers and, after a solid help during the fight against Umu, boss of the Teacher's Archive, vanishes near the Blue Lake, having finally discovered this cyan water that was causing the perpetual rain on the city. He lost his memory. It's only after the fight against Umu that he regained his memories and remembered why he was so drawn to Monomon's archives. Perhaps this is the reason why he quickly bonded with the knight when they both found themselves in front of the Temple of the Black Egg at the beginning of the adventure. It's a bit hard to talk about memory for our player character. We know nothing of what happened between the time they escaped from the Abyss, it is not explained how they escaped, and the moment they returned to Hallownest. They can't communicate anything, neither to the player. There is no internally focalized narrative, and the knight doesn't write anything except for updating the maps. Nor to the other NPCs, since they have neither mind nor voice. They're very mysterious, but the simple fact that they're always venturing further and further into the kingdom makes them an outstanding fighter. It is partly this aura that often draws NPCs to the hero, but in the case of Quirrell, it is perhaps the unfathomable nature of the hero's mind that attracts Quirrell himself without memories at that moment, simply guided by his instinct to the archives. Quirrell seems to have an interesting backstory and connected to one of the dreamers. It is quite logical that he is also the hero of a short comic strip made by Team Cherry in which he precisely meets Hornet. Cloth is a fighter who wanders just like the knight. She overcomes her fears and regains her confidence only to unfortunately perish in battle, helping the knight. She hides but is not afraid to reveal her weaknesses to the knight. Perhaps in a case, the silence of the little hero reassures her, because nothing in them seems to convey any judgment. Indeed, she introduces herself as a fighter, but fears the increasingly repulsive and infected creatures she meets, especially in Deep Nest or in the Ancient Basin, where she can be saved from lesser Morlocks. What could almost be humiliating for Cloth allows her, thanks to the absence of judgment of the little hero, they can't blame her in the way that they probably can't feel anything similar to this, and the example they seem to be setting for the gentle warrior to overcome her fears and, one would think, move forward. As for Hornet, we can't really talk about companionship. She's suspicious, and we understand it. We know that she's the daughter of Hera, one of the three dreamers, and the paid king. She, too, is aware that the infection has returned and must be sure of the intentions and the strength of the little knight. She must, therefore, subject them to increasingly difficult fights while guiding them. In front of the fountain, she tells them where to find the king's brand, where she will challenge them a second time, and at the top of the abyss, she talks about the decision the hero has to make, as they can either replace the vessel or face the radiance. In fact, there's a third possibility, Hornet, but you won't like it. The way she perceives the hero evolves from contempt to a form of admiration. What they're accomplishing, accepting the void within them and unifying it, is extraordinary, and Hornet in turn will know how to help them when the time comes. I'll come back to Hornet in a later video. There are also NPCs who have nothing but their own story to offer, like poor Bretta, who got lost near the Mantis village. Well, she has a masked jar to offer. The knight rescues her, and Bretta falls in love with them. Indeed, she starts writing fanfictions about them and decorates her home with a knight plush toy. I can't blame her, I happen to have that very plush toy. And posters. And a hug pillow. And, too many ends, should the knight sit next to her on a bench long enough, she blushes. It's all the more adorable that the knight falls asleep or loses consciousness on her shoulder after a while. Cuteness overload. This won't happen though if you decide to rescue Zote. Zote the mighty, knight of great as unpleasant as possible and not predisposed to modesty, author of 57 precepts, either full or devoid of common sense. If he's lucky enough to be rescued several times by the knight, he ends up seducing Bretta. He's also a poor fighter. His weapon, Life Ender, is made of wood, and he's incapable of doing anything with it. His voice is the game's true infection, and yet, at the bottom of this sea of mediocrity, there's proof of his clear-sightedness. His last precept, in which he invites the hero not to dream, since it is from dreams that the infection locks us away. But more than their rather classic function, non-player characters in Hollow Knight stand out in that they all seem to be trapped in a multifaceted sadness or meet a gruesome fate. Many NPCs have a moving, if not poignant, story. I have already mentioned Quirrell and Cloth, but they're not the only souls lost in their melancholy. Nate Smith has a blacksmith's shop deeply buried in the City of Tears, reclusive, unaware of the world he belongs to and its profound changes, he improves the knight's weapon throughout the game and once his work's done, he asks the knight to kill him. He wants to feel the edge of the purest blade he has ever forged. If he's spared, however, he goes to discover the world and makes a beautiful encounter. Shio, a former nail master who has become a painter, unlike his two brothers, Oro and Mato, who remain fighters and all dream of each other. Mila's destiny is also quite moving as she succumbs to this kingdom's plague. When we first encounter her, she is singing a funny nursery rhyme in Crystal Peak's mind. Shortly afterwards, Mila becomes in turn infected and attacks us like a regular enemy. She kept on digging and both the infection and, I guess, the crystals altered her state of mind, as illustrated by the voice acting that goes from overly adorable to ultimate zombie. And if you don't think it's that bad, here's what she thinks when she's infected. Yep, this is indeed the Radiance in capital letters that orders her to kill the little hero. And to dig, I assume. She then becomes a regular enemy that we can actually kill, but this is something I cannot bring myself to do. She still remembers her song though. This melancholy is reinforced by the fact that happiness systematically appears to be over. Happy moments no longer seem to belong to the present. For example, in one of her dialogues, triggered if we wear the charm obtained by defeating the Dark Defender, the White Lady wants to see Grimm again. She recalls happy memories. What were those? Unfortunately, she says nothing more. However, this isn't the only game with a dark atmosphere. Take Bloodborne, for instance. Father Gascoigne's story is just overly sad. He no longer recognizes his wife Viola, who came to look for him, and he kills her, and you have to break the news to one of their daughters after killing Gascoigne himself, and after that it's even more gloomy. But where in Bloodborne it seems difficult to imagine any glimmer of hope or sweetness, and then you have to admit, One Reborn is not particularly pleasant to look at. I love Bloodborne, I find the bosses extraordinary, but we're rather dealing with monsters in general, right? I mean, I wouldn't have Darkbeast Pal as a pet. In Hollow Knight, the characters are for the most part just adorable, except for Zote, whom I refuse to qualify as such. They simply were overcome by a torpor like that deep sleep in which the kingdom has fallen. Its melancholy is all the more touching because it is very nuanced. On the other hand, there's a NPC who just wants to eat us, making sure not to reveal a culinary desire. We can discover that near the mushroom she is eating, there is an insect that probably could not manage to escape her cruel appetite. This is Widow, a kind of giraffe insect.
Yeah, yeah.
She's not the only one, since Salubra has her eyes, rather her mouth, on us. As for the midwife, she's insisting a bit too much about her starving, if you want my opinion. It must be pointed out that Hallownest is also full of dangers and the game often plays tricks on us. When she finds herself rich enough, Minibelle runs away from a fake bank with our money. We find her later on in the pleasure house and we can even recover more than what she stole from us by hitting her shell with our nail, but in the meantime nothing could let us know that we would get our juice back. It also makes us do something a bit disturbing as we're hitting her over and over. The only clue about the greedy banker is very hidden. If we wear the Dream Shield charm or one of the charms that make small bugs appear and hit the enemies in our place, they will attack Minibelle, betraying her uncharitable intentions. In the same way, another time, we are proposed to deposit all of our fortune in a fountain to honor the paid king. In reality, you only give 3,000 geos, but there's no way for us to know that beforehand. Some grubs are actually mimics and attack us. After that, we are on our guard even in front of these creatures, no matter how frighteningly adorable they are. Even the things that seem safe to us aren't safe anymore, like when the forgotten crossroads become the infected crossroads and the area is no longer filled with casual enemies but with deeply infected kamikaze bugs. Finally, an intriguing doppelganger turns out to be a more than irritating boss, less, however, than the Watcher Knights, in my humble opinion. The charming boss. Beyond the traps inside the kingdom, therefore linked to the diegesis, to the universe of the story, in a video game there can be a sort of manipulation of the player by the developers. As we approach the Hunter's Lair in Green Path, we hear the same music as before entering the False Knight's boss room. Is this kind of sound effect diegetic? Is it in the scene? Is it safe? Some music is indeed diegetic. In the tramway or in the resting room in the Queen's Gardens, there is a loudspeaker playing the music you always hear when you're on a bench, reflection in the soundtrack. Usually, there is no visible sound source, so the music shouldn't be considered to be diegetic. There we see the speakers, the source is in the scene, so the music is diegetic. So, afterwards, what about the rest of the music? What about this beware something wrong is about to happen sound effect? Is the little knight supposed to hear it? You would think that they're not, but who knows? The same holds for Nim, who relentlessly plays the theme from Dirtmouth on the accordion after the troop is banished. It's very accurate, there are even little F-sharp octaves when the theme is played again. In this case, the music is diegetic, so was it before? But Elderbug only mentions this music when Nim plays, so we can guess it wasn't. The question is all the more important because, as I will develop at length in the next video, music has a great narrative dimension and often seems to depict characters or places. So there is this manipulation of the diegesis so as to play with the player, convinced of an imminent fight when they're about to make a mere encounter. It's not necessarily new, but what is very convincing here is to blur the lines about what is diegetic or not, to succeed in making us believe that everything is in the game and to make of Hollow Knight an even more coherent experience. Also, it's a way to induce tension since the camera never zooms in or out, while gameplay-wise, it implies that we don't have access to the level design of a difficult area. Such effects can have an impact on what the player is feeling. A zoom in may, for instance, induce tension, while a zoom out can give us satisfaction when it allows us to see a beautiful background. Here we never see Hallownest in its glory, nor do we even see Hallownest's treasures in their entirety, only one part at a time, like this story we hear, read, and learn a few words at a time. In spite of the very established features that are common to almost any video game of this genre, the way NPCs are treated feels particularly natural in Hollow Knight. First of all, it is realistic. I talk a lot about it in the third video of this series on the gameplay and the graphics, but Hollow Knight, although set in a world of anthropomorphic insects, is an exceptionally realistic adventure where every aspect has been perfectly incorporated into the narrative. As such, we don't have the same type and amount of interactions with all the characters. Some of them befriend us, like Quirrell and Cloth, or even Sly, to whom we are actually closer than we may think through our mere purchases. Others, well, we save them or listen to them, and that's it. There are those we cross paths with a few times, but with whom the distance remains, like Tizo. Finally, there are those who don't talk to us, but whom we can still splash, of course. There are many different levels of interaction, giving these encounters a very human touch. But more than anything, NPCs have a changing role. Sly, the merchant, will bring us information about the history of Hallownest. He's actually a great nail master like the three brothers, Oro, Mato and Shio. Some characters prove to be famous fighters and help us. The most striking is undoubtedly the fight with Cloth. She's the one who gives the final strike. She dies, but her ghost expresses her gratitude. She is happy to have overcome her fear and fought alongside the knight, whose courage she seems to admire. Yet, is it courage? However, the game blurs the line, and it is a much sadder story that is told through cloth. She constantly mentions her companion Nola, who's presumably dead. The fights she's looking for are always more and more terrifying, and she herself is afraid of them, but we then understand that she's not looking for anything else but to join her dead companion. An enemy becomes an ally, a merchant invades a great past, a new friend becomes a partner in combat, and sometimes the indomitable boss tells this story. After defeating him, the Duck Defender, one of the five great knights, alone in the royal waterways, tells us how impossible it was to fight the infection, this shapeless enemy, and remembers his companion and friend Isma. Dead and surrounded by plants, Isma's tear has become a fruit that allows the knight to swim in the acidic waters of Hallownest. It is thus in a very organic way that Hollow Knight's NPCs adopt the different roles of friend, enemy, storyteller, or merchant. There's a reason why there are tens of thousands of words in Hollow Knight's script. Some of them are engraved on stones, but most of them are said by the characters in particularly spot-on interactions through words or animation. Like when Creel in The City of Tears turns to the knight when the latter sits on the bench to rest before talking to them. Elderbug raises a worried paw, in addition to emitting a faint cry, if the knight tries to join the forgotten crossroads without greeting him. Or the three mantis lords who stand up and bow to the knight after they have defeated them. The knight has earned their respect. For the player, the bond with all the NPCs is often created all the more easily because when they speak, they use very recognizable and rather funny syllables.
Really?
Which makes them particularly likable.
Papanada.
But we have sympathy for them even if they don't speak at all, by the way.
Mama!
NPCs also have lots of sighs, cries, laughters, interjections, while ghosts have no voice. Upon her death, Cloth has no voice acting anymore. While it is rather classic to use such effects when NPCs talk, Hollow Knight's voice acting is really distinctive because the length of those imaginary sentences has been well chosen, hence the strong link between what you read, what you see, and what you hear. Am I disturbing you, Nailmaster? One of my favorites is when the leftmost Mantis Lord closes the large and heavy door leading to Deepnest with the very explosive consonant, the long first syllable, then a very short one that closes the word like the door itself closes and allied by a swift leg gesture. Yep, that's the useless content you get on this channel.
Kika.
Plus, there is a lot of consistency in those imaginary words. I mentioned earlier the fact that Geo is a word we often hear when merchants speak. There's of course Bama, which is pronounced several times, at least by the Nail Masters.
Bama. Finelo.
And Sly.
Bama.
That's a decent Bama indeed. Some sentences also pass from one character to the other. We get used to them as we would do for an actual language. There's also a strong variety in all the different voices. I doubt that there are many voice actors, the developers themselves having taken care of several characters each, but they all show great versatility in their vocal abilities. Cloth goes from the most infinite softness to a demonstration of strength.
Aha!
And the midwife has two voices. Just as she has two faces. I also enjoy how you hear Creel's voice sounding more and more exhausted after he finally has found Monomon in her archive and during his last scene near the lake. It's actually quite poignant.
Go, Namane, Churo.
All of these interactions have one thing in common. During each one of them, the knight, who is small in stature, stares at them, politely raising their head. As they have no voice, they do not speak, but rather listen calmly to each one of the words spoken by Hallownest's inhabitants. But of all the NPCs, none is for me more touching than Marissa, the beautiful singer, now ghost of the pleasure house in the eastern part of the City of Tears. Her audience has left, yet she remains and sings for all eternity. To honor her singing, the next step in this series will be a deep study of Hollow Knight's music and sound design. All of this was a mere introduction. See you soon.